amor entiende lo que nadie puede entender.
You never see it coming.
Quiero amarte para siempre.
And the next thing you know,
enséñame cómo amar incondicionalmente.
Ladies and gentlemen, the bride has arrived. Let's please be upstanding as we welcome her. take her arm if you want. What a stunning entrance. Welcome everybody to this great occasion. Yeah, we can clap. I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to Matthew and Nar's families. And it's great to see so many people here to support them on this day of their wedding day. It's a very special occasion. Who brings this woman to be married to this man?
I do.
Thank you. Thank you. You can take a seat. You can take a seat. You can take a seat. Okay, you guys can join hands. Well, please remain standing. We are going to begin our celebration together by singing a traditional Cook Island song. Now, I've been told that if I say the number, the hymn number, you will know what song it is. So I'm counting on you guys. Okay, the hymn we're going to sing is number 242. That's number 242. And I'm going to try and say what this is. I won't try. 242. Let's begin with this song. You want to say it?
Yeah.
I'm so glad you knew the words to that song. Please be seated, everybody. That was wonderful to hear. Probably the first time that song's been sung in this church. Isn't that great?
Go sit down. Come and stand up. Go sit down over there.
We've come together in the sight of God and in the presence of this congregation for the joining in marriage of this man, Matthew, and this woman, Na. Our Lord Jesus Christ said of marriage that from the beginning God made them male and female. For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one. So they are no longer two, but one. What therefore God has joined together, let man not put asunder. Marriage is the symbol of God's unending love for his people and the union between Christ and the church. So the Apostle Paul teaches that the husband must love the wife as Christ loved the church, and that the wife must give due honour to her husband. Marriage should be honoured by all and is not to be entered into lightly or carelessly, but with reverent and serious respect for those purposes for which it was instituted by God. Marriage is a gift from God for the well-being of mankind and for the proper expression of the natural instincts and affections for which he has endowed us. It is a lifelong union in which a man and a woman are so called to give themselves in body, mind, and spirit, and so to respond that from that their union will grow a deepening knowledge and love of each other. In the joys and sorrows of life, in prosperity and adversity, they share their companionship, faithfulness, and strength. And in marriage, a new family is established in accordance with God's purpose, so that children may be born and nurtured in secure and loving care for their well-being and instruction, and for the good ordering of society to the glory of God. Matthew and Na have now come here to be joined in this holy union to which God has led them. They seek his blessing on their life together, that they may fulfill his purpose for them, and they ask us to support them in this prayer. Therefore, if any person here can show why they may not lawfully be joined in marriage, he should speak now or hereafter remain in silence. And I charge you both, as you will answer before God, that if either of you know any reason why you may not lawfully be joined together in marriage, that you now confess it. For be assured that those who marry otherwise than God's word allows are not joined together by God, neither is their marriage lawful in his sight.
Okay, so face me, and your answer is I will in a nice loud voice, okay?
Matthew, will you have Na as your wife to live together according to God's law? Will you give her the honour due to her as your wife, and forsaking all others, love and protect her as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Na, will you have Matthew as your husband to live together according to God's law? Will you give him the honour due to him as your husband, and forsaking all others, love and protect him as long as you both shall live? Na has asked that her father come and lead them in their wedding vows. So at this point, I'm going to invite James to come forward, and he's going to take Matthew and Na through their vows together.
I'm Matthew.
In the presence of God.
Take you, Mahua.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
From this day forth.
For better or for worse.
For richer and poorer.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
As long as we both shall live.
This is my solemn vow and promise.
This is my solemn vow and promise.
I am Jehovah, in the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you, Matthew.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
This is my solemn vow and promise.
This is my solemn vow and promise.
May I have the ring, please? Let us pray. Lord, we pray that these rings may be a token and constant sign of the pledge of love and faithfulness, which these two people make to each other, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. With this ring I wed you.
With this ring I wed you.
With all that I am,
all that I am,
and all that I have,
and all that I have,
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of God.
In the name of God.
Amen. May God enable us to grow.
May God enable us to grow.
In love together. Matthew.
Matthew.
With this ring, I'm with you.
With this ring, I'm with you.
Matthew, with this ring, I wed you.
Matthew, with this ring, I wed you.
With all that I am.
With all that I am.
And with all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of God.
In the name of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Nahor.
Nahor.
I receive this ring.
I receive this ring.
In token of our marriage.
Token of our marriage.
May God enable us to grow.
May God enable us to grow.
In love together.
In love together.
Those whom God has joined together, let man not put asunder. Before God and in the presence of us all, by solemn consent and promise, by the giving and receiving of a ring, and by the joining together of hands, Matthew and Nah have now accepted each other in marriage. In the name of God, I declare them to be husband and wife. So lovely to see these two married, isn't it? It's wonderful. I'm going to invite James again to come and read from God's Word. We're going to read from the Gospel of John.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Then he stood 6 stone jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Now he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests had no too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana in Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the gospel.
Thank you, James. Let me say again, Wula Bula and Manaka. That's about all the Fijian I know. Manaka for being here. It's great to have you here with us. First impressions are lasting, aren't they? First impressions. Didn't Na make a great first impression? Coming down that aisle, what a beautiful bride she is. And the wedding dress all the way from Fiji. Wow, it was worth it. We have the coming together of Fiji and the Cook Islands. We expect the kids to be great rugby players, don't we? No pressure, kids. But what a stunning first entrance, first appearance that we saw here today. I don't know the first impression that Matthew made upon Na when he first met her. How did he woo her? Hopefully we'll hear more of that later at the reception, hey? Was she impressed with his air condition installing skills? Maybe that was the thing that impressed her. But we'll find out later, we hope. But first impressions are lasting. And in this passage that James just read for us, Jesus makes his very first impression. He's at a wedding, just like we are. And there's lots of people at this wedding, just like we are. And it's a very happy occasion, just like today. And you could imagine someone like Jesus being the greatest leader in all of history. And he wants to make a great first impression, a lasting impression. He has many miracles that he can choose from to make a first impression, can't he? He can feed a football stadium full of people with 5 buns and 2 bits of fish. He can do that. He can walk on water. That would get people's attention, wouldn't it? He can raise the dead. Wow, that would really turn eyes if he did that one. They would get your attention. But do you know the very first miracle that Jesus chose to do to introduce himself? You know what it was? He turned water into wine. I can think of a few more exciting miracles to do, can't you, than that one. But this is the one that he chose at this wedding. It's an impressive miracle, but some of the others have a bit more bang to them, don't they? Why did he choose this one as his entrance? What we're being shown here in this story about Jesus that we just read are two very important things about Jesus
that Matthew and Na, I want you to remember about Jesus to carry into your marriage. Okay? Here's the first one. The first one I want you to remember. I want you to remember, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? Okay, because what we're being told here is that Jesus came to be the real bridegroom. Let me explain. See, there's one little incy-wincy incidental catering nightmare that takes place at this wedding. They run out of wine. Can you imagine what it would be like if we went to the reception later and the wedding planner comes up to Matthew and says, Matthew, we've got a bit of a problem. We've run out of food. And Matthew has to get up and explain to everyone, I'm sorry, guys, if you want food, you're going to have to duck down to Macca's and get yourself a cheeseburger and come back and we'll eat together. That would be embarrassing, wouldn't it? It would be a nightmare. It would be a social embarrassment. And especially in this culture, when weddings would actually go on for days and days and days. And to run out of wine at a wedding like this would mean that the bridegroom has egg on his face. And so it's amazing that Jesus chooses as his very first miracle to make gallons and gallons of the finest vintage wine that you've ever tasted. See, we're told here that there's 150 gallons of this wine. 150 gallons. I got my calculator and I discovered that that's about 650 bottles of wine. Imagine trying to get that through customs, right? That's huge. It's a pretty good wedding present, isn't it, that Jesus gives to this wedding couple. It's extravagant, but it's quality wine. In fact, it's so good that the master of the banquet says, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink, but you have saved the best till now. See, the point is, Jesus doesn't make ordinary wine. He makes excellent wine. It's better than the wine before. But do you see the point? Jesus does what the bridegroom should have done. It was the bridegroom's job to provide for the wine, and Jesus steps in, and you know what he's saying? He's saying, I'm the real bridegroom. I'm the one who keeps the party going. I'm the one who brings celebration into your life. That's what he's saying. Because wine in the Bible often stands for joy and celebration and gladness. And what Jesus is doing by choosing this miracle as his first miracle, you know what he's saying? He's making a statement. He's saying, I'm the bridegroom. I'm the real bridegroom. I'm the one who comes into your life to make your life a celebration. I come to make your life a party. I come to bring joy and gladness. And so Matthew and Na, what Jesus is showing you today is that he is the real bridegroom. Sorry, Matthew. There's another bridegroom. It's Jesus. And he wants you to know that there's really three people in your marriage. There's you, Matthew, there's Na, and in the center is Jesus. Okay, there's three people in your marriage, and the center is Jesus. And you'll find that if you make Jesus the center of your marriage, what he will do is he will turn your marriage into a place of joy and celebration when he's at the center. That's what he came to do. He says, I want to come into your marriage, I want to come into your life, and I want you to know the joy of knowing me, having a relationship with me. And so Matthew and Mark, can I encourage you in your marriage? Make much of Jesus and little of yourself. For when you make much of Jesus, you make much of your marriage, let me tell you. Jesus wants your marriage to get better and better and better every passing year. And so make much of Jesus. Do that by reading the Bible together. Do that by being a couple that prays together. Do that by being a couple that comes along to church regularly. And that will help you make him your center. So that's the first thing. Remember who Jesus is. Here's the second thing that this story tells us and teaches us. It teaches us what Jesus came to do. What he came to do. See, there's a hint of what he came to do in this story. Because we read in verse 3, when the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. Dear woman, why do you involve me? Jesus replied, my time has not yet come. Here's a mum
coming to her son, saying, they need more wine. She knows who Jesus is, right? She knows what he can do. I mean, she's been through a virgin birth with him, right? She understands that, this kid, this man now, is special. And so Jesus responds by saying, my time has not yet come. Why does he say that? What timetable is he on? Is he in a hurry to do something? My time has not yet come. Time for what? Do you know, when we come to the end of John's Gospel, we discover that his time does come, actually. It is time for something. And you know what it's time for? It's time for him to die. It's time for him to die. See, the time that Jesus is thinking about when he says, my time has not yet come, he's thinking about his crucifixion, when he will die on that cross. Why is he talking about his death at a wedding? That seems a bit strange, doesn't it? But let me tell you, this wedding that he's at, it reminds him of the future wedding. Do you know there's a future wedding coming? See, weddings are about two people becoming one. You know that? And that's what we're here to celebrate today. We're here to celebrate Matthew and Nah becoming one. But do you know God wants to be one with every single one of us? He wants to be one at the wedding of all weddings. How can we be one with God? Well, we can't if we ignore him. We can't if we go on disobeying him. We can't be one with him if we treat him like a genie in a bottle who is just there to give me my wishes. No, the Bible says for us to be one with him, you know what needs to happen? We need to die. And Jesus Christ is the one who steps in and says, no, I don't want them to die. I will die in their place. Not them, but me. Take me. I'll die so that God can be one with his people. Jesus had to die on the cross for this to happen, for this wedding to take place. See, on the cross, do you remember what Jesus said? It is finished. You know why he said that? Because he had finished paying the punishment for all of our sins. So he's at a wedding, there's no more wine, and he remembers the future wedding when God would be one with his bride. And he remembers he has to die in order to get to this future wedding so we can be one with him. So Matthew and Nah, can I just say to you, remember what Jesus did for you. Remember what he went through so that you can be one with God. He died on the cross for you. What great love he has, eh? For you guys. What a wonderful God we have. And so if ever you want to... you know how to be the best kind of lover in your marriage, you know where you look to? You look to Jesus, because he'll teach you what it means to be a great lover. Flood yourself with his love for you. You know those promises you just made in front of all of us? Jesus wants you to keep those promises every single day of your life. And that's challenging, isn't it? It's easy to say yes to those promises on a day like today. I mean, look at these guys. Look at how they've scrubbed up. Don't they look good? It's easy to say yes to these promises on a day like today. But what about next Monday? When life goes back to normal? You know, when all those bad habits come back? You know, when the mud pack goes on your face and the cucumbers go on your eyes when you're wanting to sleep? Or you leave your hairbrush lying around, and then there's the hours of time that you spend talking to your mum on the phone and walking around in your tracky dacks and your Uggies. And man, that's just Matthew. Imagine the bad habits that Nah has. Wow. The challenge is to love after this day. Look at how Jesus has loved you. So, guys, this first miracle is actually a perfect miracle for Jesus to do, because it shows us that Jesus came to be our lover, to take us back to God. And he wants to relate to us as a bridegroom relates to a bride. He came to give us joy. This is a happy day, this is a joyous day, but it's a reminder of an even greater joy that all of us can have, having a relationship with God. And our prayer is upon you guys as you start out your married life. Now, at this point in our service, we are going to sing a traditional Fijian hymn. And again, I'm told that everyone who's Fijian will know this hymn. And so I'm going to invite us to stand. Let's please be upstanding, and we will sing this hymn together. Especially upon your servants, Matthew and Nah, as they enter into their new life together. in your love, deepen their love. Strengthen their wills to keep the important promises that they have made, so they may live to your glory and for the good of mankind, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty Father, you have created us in your own image, and by your gracious gift, mankind grows. To Matthew and Na, we pray that you will give them wisdom in the loving care and the nurture of their family. Father, we pray for Taylor, Michael, Takura, Gwen, Andre, and Matthew. Father, we pray that they and their children would honour you and that they would know you in their lives and give you praise and glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And our Heavenly Father, we pray for ourselves that you would help us all to trust in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and to live according to your will through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, friends, Matthew and Na are about to come and sign some legal papers to make everything legal, and everything's going to be official, and after that there will be a good opportunity for photos. But during the signing, we'll be singing another song. And so the song that we'll be singing is a Cook Island hymn, number 281. 281. And I'm going to invite you again to be standing as we sing. But I'll invite the groom and the bridegroom to come forward with their witnesses as we sign some papers.
On the cheek. Yep. Plus quick.
Take care of you, huh?